Boy, how's that for a nanny state update? Julie Gundlach joins us of the Independent Women's Forum. Don't think we have any stories about band and dancing today, Julie.
I know. Shocking.
Thankfully.
Give it time.
Give me 10 minutes. I could probably come up with something. How are you doing?
I'm doing pretty good.
Yeah?
Yeah, getting back into the swing of things after the holiday. I mean, there's no excuse now. You really have to be back to your routine.
Yes, it's almost mid-January.
If you're not back in the routine, there's something wrong with you.
It really is.
But it was tough. And there's so many school cancellations. You know, for the 1/18th of snow, 1/18th inch of snow that we got in the Washington, D.C. area. So.
Yeah, well, from what I understand, I'm not in Northern Virginia anymore, but from my social media last week, it seems like there were a lot of people who were upset with the school system in Northern Virginia and Fairfax County for not delaying or canceling school when you got that 1/8 of an inch of snow, and then the next day, canceling school when everything was fine.
Yes, that's what they do. Yeah, it's incredibly frustrating. I'm not making a lot of friends here in the Northern Virginia area, but it's very frustrating. And look, I grew up in the Midwest. I grew up in snow country, so this is all, it's sort of ridiculous for me to watch. But yeah, so this week, and on Monday, we had another 2-hour delay for some cold rain.
We did have a 2-hour delay down in Farmville as well and it was the wind chill. It was because it was really cold, and they didn't want the kids standing out there waiting for the bus.
Whatever. What's the vacation of America?
I hated walking to school, though, when it was cold.
Has anyone heard of a scarf or a hat? Put it on. Go to school. God.
Okay.
Okay.
Problem solved. You're fired up about that, right?
I have a heart of stone. I have a heart of stone about this kind of stuff.
All right, so what's the latest with the food nannies? What are they after this week?
Well, I wrote about how there's this new head of the Let's Move.
Oh, yes, a very activist.
Yes, she really
type,
is.
Right?
She's a food activist. Now, a lot of people probably are familiar with the name Sam Cass. He was actually the Obama's personal chef. I mean, talk about right place, right time. Right, he was the personal chef to the Obama family. I think he started when Barack Obama was elected to the Senate, or even before that. But you know, he certainly was not the personal chef to the presidential family, and he came to Washington with them, continued to cook their personal meals, and eventually ran the Let's Move campaign and became a policy analyst for the First Lady, in charge of all her food policy decisions. And so he was a very powerful figure in Washington. So he has left now, and it's been turned over to this Deb Eschmeyer woman, I'm sure, who is a lovely woman, but she runs a sort of AmeriCorps for school gardens, and it sends people, this activist organization that she runs, sends people into school districts, poorer school districts, to set up school gardens and to teach children how to garden, where their food comes from. We're all familiar with this whole line of reasoning.
It's horrible. How dare she do that?
Well, look, some of the stuff that she says, though, is she believes in a full transformation of the American agriculture system. She's an organic farmer. She pushes for organic food and for the acceptance of organic foods. And a lot of, you know, farmers in this country object to that. And certainly these are more expensive foods. I certainly object to poorer Americans being told that organic food is better for their children. It's not. There have been multiple studies comparing conventionally grown vegetables and fruits and their organic counterparts, and there is not one single nutritional difference between the two. So we should be advising, you know, people with limited resources to spend those resources on the food that they can afford. And so I do object to that. So she's taken over Let's Move, and we're probably going to see some more more activism coming out of that office. It's debatable whether this is going to be a very active office in these waning years of the Obama administration, but I think it's worth noting that that the administration has put in place someone with sort of as an activist sort of resume as this woman, and someone who has some pretty radical ideas about the food system in this country.
The ideas about remaking American agriculture, I think, is really interesting, particularly given that, you know, the school systems have enormous buying power, right?
Yeah.
Particularly when and when those school systems are mandated to act in certain ways, then all of a sudden the buying power of these school districts is really the buying power of Uncle Sam.
You know, the other part that is really, and you mentioned like this buying power. I mean, the other thing that's really disturbing to me is that she pushed and continues to push for these, you know, reforms in the school lunch program, and yet doesn't really discuss how they've been an utter failure, and that we need more reforms to the reforms that happened in 2010. We've got a school lunch program in this country that has continually been reformed. I think I've mentioned on this show before that we always talk about how, oh goodness, the reforms in 2010 that Michelle Obama shepherded through Congress were, you know, they were really like the first time the school lunch program has been reformed. That's not true. The school lunch program has, you know, these eager members of Congress, they, you know, every couple of years someone introduces some bill. Tom Harkin has worked on this issue for years and years and years, and yet the school lunch program is still dealing with terrible fraud. There's actual criminal cases and terrible mismanagement. It is just impervious to reform. And so what I'd like to see is some talk about privatization, bringing restaurants. And look, school districts can say no French fries, no burgers. It's only like salads and, you know, and grilled meats. And if that's what they want to do, that's what they can do. But restaurants would be happy to gain this customer base. And so, and I think students would be a lot happier if and look, these guys know how to cook a lot better in some cases than schools. So I would love to see some more innovation, but unfortunately, I think with this woman, we're going to see sort of the same mantra about how we need to continue to pump federal taxpayer dollars into these broken programs, and that's kind of sad.
Well, I can only hope one day, Julie, while your kids are picking beans during PE class and then counting them out during math class, that that you will appreciate really the nature's bounty that can be grown in our school district.
Oh, please. Okay, look, I am never going to teach my kids about, I mean, yeah, I'll talk to them about farming. I'll talk to them because that interests me. These are the issues I work on. But look, you know what we need to teach our kids? We need to teach them these principles that in this country, and I wrote this in this piece, that in this country, you don't have to be a farmer in order to eat, okay? That this country is made up of all sorts of different, people who do different things. And because I'm not good at farming, I'm not even good at a little plot of land in my backyard, creating, crops and that, I use the grocery store, and I rely on farmers who do it better. And I think this kind of narrative that, people say things like, oh, well, food is free when you grow it yourself. It is not. I mean,
it's not.
I mean, I try every year to grow a garden. It's a pathetic little garden in my backyard. I try every year. I prep the soil. I spend a ton of money prepping the soil and buying plants and buying seeds. And my time is, I take time away from all I do is scream at the kids, get out of the garden. So I'm not spending quality time with the kids. I'm not cooking or reading or doing something I want to do. I mean, there's also my own opportunity costs here. And so I kind of disagree with this idea that we have to, every child has to learn the ins and out of farming and how to grow food and all this other stuff. You know, I'm going to teach my kids to go to the grocery store, live near a grocery store. I'm not going to teach them to can. I'm going to teach them. I'm going to show them the aisle that has canned goods. I mean, because I don't want a can. I mean, I don't think my grandmother wanted to can either. She was forced to. So, you know, I think we need to. Some of this stuff is kind of silly and really, I think, counterproductive. I think kids need to learn to read and write, and they need to know basic math, and they need to know these things that schools should be teaching our kids. I think wasting time on some of these things is really unfortunate.
All right, Ms. Gunlock. We'll talk again soon.
Ending on another cheerful note. I got to start being more positive at the end of our interview.
No, that was pretty positive. You still want some bacon, though, right?
That's right. Are you kidding?
Okay. All right. We've got some curing right now.
All right, good.
All right, we'll talk to you soon.
Thanks for having me.
Julie Gunlock of the Independent Women's Forum.